makes lights, so it should work, right?
Okay.
So I would like to speak on the status of the Intel Procedure Optimizers in GCC. The reason I speak about it on this summit is because I do it for a long time. But the main reason is that I think we are getting the link time optimization support into the shape is actually useful for production. And so we are going to see more of use of it. And the Intel Procedure Optimizers are, of course, the important part of the game, you know, to get some gains from the link time optimization. So I expect that the work on the Intel Procedure Optimization will get more interesting than in a couple past years. And I would also like to apologize for the appearance of my slides. First, you know, I decided to use the OpenOffice, and I'm simply not smart enough to get something pretty out of it. And second, I was really working hard to get some data. And first, there was the record heats in Czech Republic, and I turned it off the server room because of overheating. Then I was traveling in Scotland for some whiskey tasting, so I was not in the shape to start the benchmarks. And then I collected the data for the last few days, but this is how it looks today. So, no, I still have some useful data, but I really tried to get something more. So, what's the overview of my talk? Now, first I will speak a little bit of what kind of IPA infrastructure we have on the place. Then I will speak about the different IPA passes. And as everyone knows, the only important IPA pass in existence is the inliners, so that's the third part of my talk. And I will hopefully explain, you know, why the other IPA passes does nothing. So, one of the relatively surprisingly new elements in the GCC is the symbol table. I started to work on it about 2 years ago. And these days, it's kind of useful. And I actually basically took the existing call graph and Warpool, which we implemented about a decade ago, and updated it into the symbol table. So the way the symbol table looks these days, that is that we have the symbol nodes. The symbol nodes are holding the default stuff you would expect there, like the pointer to the declaration. At the moment, every symbol has a corresponding declaration. There is a one-to-one correspondence. The visibility info, which I'm slowly shifting away from the visibility in the declaration to the visibility in the symbol table itself. And the partitioning info, because for the whole program optimization, we do this partitioning at the link time. So the partitioning info is no part of the symbol table. And we generally have two different types of symbols. There are function symbols and variable symbols, which are still called the Warpool and C-graph. I will rename it into something less strange. But before I run the set, I will probably wait a little bit, so I break the patches at the last minute. And every symbol is either a definition or non-definition. The definition is not exactly corresponding to the external symbols or non-external symbols in C. For example, the external inlines are definitions, or if you have the C++ symbol, the virtual tables, which are keyed to the different unit, they are also external definitions. So the definition is simply the symbol where you know the contents. And that's one of the presentation problems. And the definitions in the functions has three different types. They are either the typical functions, as you would expect, with the GIMPL body in it. They are the funcs, which are not having a GIMPL representation. They are kind of on-site because they are very special. They have to do this adjustment for variadic instructions, and we don't really have a GIMPL representation for it, and we probably don't need it. And there are aliases, which is something I spent incredible amount of time on it. And it goes the same day for the variables. We have variables, we have aliases, we don't have funcs. And the aliases has three different types, which was kind of a surprise to me. The normal aliases is what you expect when you are writing the alias directive. It's a basically alternative name of some other symbol. We also have the vcrefs, which is something which makes me crazy for months. And there are something like 5 users of this in the world, but it needs a lot of care in GCC. So it's a basically alias, which is alias of something not in your unit. And It's a kind of alternative name which is translated by assembler to the final name, so it doesn't really get as a real alias. So the difference is, for example, in the normal alias, if you have the alias of some symbol and you overwrite the symbol by linker, then the alias stays on the place. It's still pointing to the previous declaration. But with the vcref, you know, if you rewrite the symbol, the vcref also change. So it has a different semantic. And we have the external aliases, which is something officially generated by C++. For example, when you have two different symbol tables, which you know they are equivalent, and they are sitting in the different compilation unit. So that's how the symbol table looks, at least from the high level point of view. Not all parts are completely finished. One of the things we definitely need to represent are labels. The reason is that you can take address of the label, you can store it into the variable, and if we are driving partitioning by symbol table, we have to be sure to put the label and the variable pointing to the label to the same partition. So we need a representation for labels, and we also need to do something with the constants, because the GCC is making difference between variables and constant declarations. And generally, I think it's kind of a historical thing. I think they can basically turn to be variables, because historically the main difference between the constdecl and vardecls was that the constdecls was optimized away, the vardecls wasn't. And we are handling the same optimizations on the variables. So generally, I would like to remove constants and rather than inventing some new representation for them. So that's for the symbol table. And one extra thing is that we probably want to represent the alternative entry points of functions at some point. That would be useful for C++, like the funcs might be faster, and it might be useful for Fortran, which is also having this in the language. And I'm sure that Go or some other language will invent it too. So, or C++, you know. So that's my plans for a symbol table. As you see, the plans are in red, which was something I can do in LibreOffice. And basically, I want to do this big renaming at some point. I would like to actually use C++ for inheritance, because we have this simple inheritance hierarchy. But I can't, because the garbage collector is in the way. So I don't know how to do it. You know, if I make the cGraph node to be ancestor of the symbol node, then the garbage collector explodes.
All right, we can
solve it for me, yeah. Because the current syntax is kind of ugly, you know, I do this C inheritance in C++, which doesn't really fly. And the next thing is that I would really put the decor assembler names into the symbol table. And generally, I would like to get away from the assembler names, which is not the symbol name, it's a symbol name plus some manglings around. And have the real symbol names in the symbol table and these manglings somewhere around, which is a lot of work because it's everywhere in the output machinery and target machinery. It has a target specific behavior, so it's a beautiful thing. And yeah, I would like to move all the symbol visibility stuff into the symbol nodes. So for example, the linking can be done on the symbol table only without looking on the declarations. And I would like to get rid of the hash, because currently we have the hash which is mapping symbols and symbol nodes. So the next part of the infrastructure is the call graph. The call graph these days is basically just the data structure which is representing the edges. And the call graph edge is basically a call site, and we have two types. We have the direct edges, which are linking the caller and the callee, and we have indirect edges, which are sitting in the caller and pointing nowhere. So what I would like to improve on this is first the representation of the virtual calls. For the virtual calls, we can definitely get the set of the possible destination of the call from the C++ inheritance, which is something which would be useful for dead code removal. Because, for example, at the moment we are keeping all virtual functions we see in the program until very late of the compilation, because we are not sure if we will ever use it for the virtualization. So I think it's actually consuming quite a lot of memory for LTO, because you get a lot of virtual functions coming from the headers, and they are sitting there and doing nothing. And of course, if we had useful points to representation, then we can also handle the indirect edges. We can do useful propagation out of it, and actually optimize across the edges. The next part of the infrastructure is the IP references, which is basically a very simple reference recording where you are taking address of something, when you are reading the global variables, and when you are writing to the global variable. The main point is to allow very quick dead code removal, because if you have no references, no calls, then you can remove the object, maybe. And also, it's controlling the partitioning. So all the references has to be represented so the partitioning works. And we have the IP reference path, which is trying to optimize across the static variables. Here, I would like to get some kind of container reference linking the fact that one symbol is actually part of the representation of the other symbol, instead of having special representations for inline clothes and aliases. And the next part of the infrastructure is the IPA propagation engine, which is maintained by Martin mostly. And it's basically the constant propagation propagation engine. So it's computing the jump function, which tells you from the partial assignments of the function parameters what parameters will be passed to given call. And it's also doing the type-based virtualization, which is after many years doing something. It's doing about 400 calls on Mozilla, which is not too bad, but it's doing 4,000 calls on the Chromium. About 4 weeks ago, it was 12, so we improved. And then also it's doing the indirect call resolution. So again, we get some non-zero percentage, is something like 3% overall of indirect calls optimized to the direct calls, which pays back, of course. And this is only for the inter-procedural part. We do the devirtualization on the local part, which is not accounting in these numbers. And there are many things which can be improved. We are able to track the scalar parameters. We are also able to track the aggregate parameters. But we don't do it so as well as we should in many cases, because the code is kind of simple. We have no support for the return functions, which might be useful like for even for the local passes. Like if you do CSE or global value numbering, you know what the return value of the function is, you can put it into your set. We can always get stronger jump functions. I still think that the virtualization doesn't work as well as it should, but I don't really understand it, so I cannot tell. The last bigger component is the inline analysis. I have separate slides about this later. It's kind of independent component these days, which is trying to predict the function's execution time and the size depending on the context it is in. So it can tell you quite a lot about the function it's used, for example, to drive the constant propagation cloning heuristics. So it's useful to predict what they are going to do. So this is the main overview of how the path manager works. The main difference here is that we do this whole program optimization in two stages. So we have the local optimization part where we are trying to do as much as possible on the compile time, because the compile time is free and parallel. And then we have it probably disappeared. So we have the local optimization part. We have the simpler IPA passes, which are executed at the compile time. And then we have the proper IPA passes, which are split into three parts. So the analysis, which is done on the compile time, the propagation, which is supposed to be as fast as possible, which is running on the whole program, and the transformation part, which is running again in parallel at the link time. So there are many things which can be cleaned up on the path manager, as many of the developers knows. And yeah, this is the overview of how the path structure looks like. So the blue passes are actually the IPA passes. So we do a visibility pass, which is having the purpose to identify what symbols can be local and optimized across. We have the array optimization, which is a kind of set of the simple but effective local passes, and it's doing the early inlining, and it's doing the IPA SRA, which is breaking up function arguments and removing the dead arguments. And we do the analysis. And this is what we do on the link time. We do the symbol resolution, then we do the whole program analysis. We do it again because the whole program visibility, because with the link time feedback, we know what symbol is actually local to us. You know, the linker can tell us. And yeah, we do the passes we hedge, which is the profile pass, constant propagation, constructor making, pull cons, reference, and inlining, partitioning, and streaming. So, okay, so I would like to get through the individual passes we have and tell a little bit more about what they do, what they don't, and if they are effective. So the first pass in the queue is the whole program visibility. So as I thought, we get the feedback from the linker, which is saying, you know, this symbol is the symbol which is local to your LTO world, and it says this symbol is a symbol which is exported. There is another resolution for it. And what we do with it is that we are trying to make as many symbols as possible static, and then we look for the functions which are not having address taken, and we make it local. The local function can have changes in the calling conventions. And the more interesting part of this is how to handle the comdats, because when we do LTO, we are basically trying to aggressively turn comdats into the static, which is something you cannot do on the normal compilation model, because you want the comdats to be reused. But in the LTO, we actually want it to not be reused, because it's adding extra relocation costs. And yeah, this is kind of effectivity of having this localization enabled. So it makes quite a big code size reduction when you do LTO. It's something like 19%, and also causing some speed up. So it's an important important element, and I think we can still be much more aggressive on the comdat. Because, for example, we stopped on the comdat which has the address taken because we think the address might be used for equality comparison with some other comdat. But in many cases, we can simply track it will never be used, and we can also make it static. But there are not that many functions left. It's something like 4,000 comdats for Firefox. So the next pass is the IPA profile, which is at the moment very simple pass implemented in one afternoon. That is trying to propagate the profile across the call graph. So we are basically identifying the functions which are start once on the startup, which is the static constructor and the main. And we are trying to identify the functions which are called once on the exit. And we are trying to propagate this info to the callies. And also, we are trying to track the functions which are unlikely, which is generally the functions which are used for error handling or exception handling and so on. And also, if we have the profile feedback, that we make the histogram, and we are actually able to identify, you know, how big the count has to be to make the function hot. So if you run it on the Firefox, then the Firefox has something like 1 million functions after the error optimizations, 4 million functions overall. And out of that, we are able to make some non-zero percentage of those to be called on the startup and exit and executed once. The percentage is actually not so big. No, it's something like really, really below 1%. I hope this can be improved if we make a more aggressive propagation. And there are many things which I think we can do in this pass, because it's basically the code placement pass. We are at the moment splitting the function into the three sections. And one of the very disappointing things is that the code is ignoring these sections. I was able to hack it into GNU-LD, but I don't know how to improve code to handle it. And I will show you the next slide. It actually makes quite a difference. And we do the pessimistic propagation, which is, of course, a bad idea. We should make the optimistic data flow over the call graph. And we also should use the profile feedback for the proper code layout, which is something my Summer of Code student, Martin, is working on. And basically, he's measuring the order of the functions as they are executed on the runtime, and then he is ordering the functions in this order. And he is able to get pretty aggressive improvements on C++ code, like the Inkscape gets 10% faster on the startup, and it loads 50% less of pages to the memory. So I think it can make really difference if the binaries are built this way, of course, only with the profile feedback. And he also probably can do some kind of full propagation of the frequencies over the call graph, which I'm not sure how effective it might be. And the last improvement is that we now have the code attribute, which can be used by the standard libraries, but it's usually not. The code attribute is really useful because it not only makes the function to be optimized for the size, but it also makes all the calls to the code function to be unlikely executed, which helps GCC to get more information. So this is the example how the code layout problems looks like today. This is the start of the LibreOffice. So this part is the relocation info, which is already very big. It's something like 20% of your binary. There is a Firefox hack, which basically they take away all the IP relative relocations, all the relative relocations, and they compress them in a different format. They're able to get something like 20% reduction of the startup type only by compressing the relocation size. This line up is the static initialization, because C++ makes really easy to generate the static constructors, which the people don't know about. It's like including the IO stream makes you static constructor in your unit. So every unit basically gets one constructor. It's about 7,000 of them on the Firefox. And then this is actually the kind of startup part. And I guess this is the time LibreOffice needs to display the splash screen or something like that. So you know, if we are able to get rid of this part, that's actually already done. It's only the gold not able to use the sections. And this part can be significantly improved by the code layout optimizations. So Martin sent me some of his measurements. This is the Inkscape startup. Again, this is the relocation, static construction, and some random stuff. And this is how it looks after the reordering. So we have really much fewer page accesses than before. The next pass is the IPA reference pass, which is one of the early IPA passes we got, and it's basically trying to build a list of the static variables which can be modified or read by the given function. And the problem of this pass is that it does almost nothing. It saves something like 0.006% of the Firefox binary, and except for the kind of specific benchmarks, I have never seen it to improve much. And I think it's mostly because the pass is simply too simple-minded. It shouldn't work only on the static variables. It should work on the individual fields. It should work on the heap memory. And so what we probably should do with this pass is to rewrite it into some kind of proper mode reference pass, which we are missing at the moment. I don't know, I have no experience how much the mode ref pass should improve the code in practice. So I don't know how bad this is. But at the moment, I'm considering this pass to be kind of experimental pass testing that we can do something about the variables. The next thing is that we have the pure const pass, which is the pass identifying the pure and const attributes originally. But these days it's doing much more than it did before. So it's basically collecting kind of properties about the function. It's looking if the function can read a global memory. It's looking if the function can write a global memory. It's checks if the function is deterministic, like if it has a volatile ASM in it, it can change its value not only based on the parameters it's given. It's trying to prove that the function is finite, because if we want to optimize out the function call, we have to know it's a finite function. And it's also handling the exception handling. And then based on it, it's adding this pure const, no return, and no throw attributes. And it also can output a warning to the user or suggestions, you know, tell user maybe you want to put an attribute on this function, which might be useful for some of the library developers. Like I used it to annotate the libs to the C++ a couple of years ago. And I try to collect the data for the spec. So again, it does very little for specs. It's just it's not even on the slides, but it does very little of the Firefox too. There are two benchmarks where it gets lucky. It's actually by the proving that the function is cons, you know, a huge part of the binary just goes away. In general, I think this optimization is doing pretty much what it's supposed to do. The things we can improve is that this pure cons and looping flags are actually kind of better representation of what the pass is gathering. You know, we probably can have these flags instead of kind of mixed flags. And we can get better propagation for exception handling, which is really important because the more of the exception handling we can optimize away, the better. And we also can detect some of the other attributes we have, like the malloc and no capture and no null. I didn't do any experiments if it would be useful or not.
Just a note, null and non-null, if you're looking at static analysis, mm-hmm. can be extremely helpful.
Okay. Then it's a good thing to add. yeah, I think the non and non-null is useful. I sure the malloc too and no capture, so yeah.
Yeah, just from looking at how other systems mm-hmm. propagate data through the global clock graph, mm-hmm. that attribute is extremely important.
Yeah. You know, one thing which I think would make sense is to turn the IPA prop to actually handle value ranges. And then we can represent this via the return functions in a kind of more clean manner than the specific attributes. But I also didn't look into it. So the next pass is the IPA PTA, which is the points to analysis. And the current implementation is basically Richard took the existing local points to analysis and he extended it to work on the wall unit, which is probably not the way we want to implement. And it's actually also kind of spec neutral, even though it can build spec, it can build Firefox. I lost the data, but the differences are very small. And the main problems with the PTA is that it's not context sensitive, it doesn't understand the global variables very well. It's run only after partitioning, it's not run on the whole program. And IPA PTA is one of the passes which you really want to do on the whole program, because if you have just a partial info, you are lost. And it has a compile time issue, so it's not enabled by default because the bitmap representation, which works well enough for the local function, explodes in some cases. So I think we will eventually need someone with the alias analysis experience to write the proper PTA pass. So the next pass is constant propagation, which is the pass which actually the IPA prop was invented for. It was rewritten recently by Martin, so it's now able to do some kind of specialization. The original pass was basically the data flow propagation pass, and it was not able to handle the cases like when you have the function which is 1,000 times called with parameter 1 and 1,000 times called with parameter 2. You want to make two different clones, not just one clone. So that's what the pass can do today. And it's using this inline hints from alias from inline analysis to actually figure out if the cloning seems useful. So if you look on the Firefox, then we actually create very few clones. You know, out of the millions of the functions, the largest number has very few digits. So I was looking into it with Martin, and I think there is something wrong with the beneficial analysis. So basically, all the clones which we do are made for the size, and then the code gets 2% bigger. So it doesn't seem to work that well at the moment, but on the specs, it actually works better. So there are three benchmarks when it makes a measurable difference, and it's improved the code size. So obviously, there are some tuning issues, but it probably can be resolved quite soon. I think I understand where the problem is. You know, the pass is basically bottom up, it doesn't propagate much about the frequencies, and it's using the frequencies extensively to decide about the benefits. So the last pass before the inliner part is the constructor and destructor merging, which is something I invented when I was working for Firefox 3 years ago. And it's basically trying to solve the problem I was showing on the disk seeking graph. Basically, Firefox has something like 7,000 static constructors. About 2/3 of them are constructing the I/O streams. And if you turn them all into the single function, it gets much smaller. So basically, the pass looks for all the static constructions in the program which are having same priority. It puts it into the single function, and things gets in line later.
Have you talked to Firefox guys about this? Because I've gotten beat up by Tarkus about these issues.
Yeah. Actually,
they're using this now.
Yeah. They are. Well, you know, they are using. There were several changes to improve the construction. First, you know, we switch from this backward execution to the forward execution, which is better for the seeking. And then I made these sections, which I really hope someone will fix in the Gold. You know, I'm just not good enough to make a template to do it.
The IO stream construction specifically only needs to happen once.
Exactly, but they are in every unit. Just, you know, they are in every unit just to be sure.
Yeah,
so that's the other thing we can,
the extra calls.
Yeah. We can have an attribute that this function can be called just once, and we can optimize the address.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I don't think it's a so big deal. It's a single function call per compilation unit. You have 7,000 calls extra in Firefox. It's 60 megs of binary. You don't gain that much. But yeah, that's something I was thinking about too. And so yeah, for Firefox and some of the other stuff, it worked pretty well. So. That's the first part of the talk. So if you have any questions about the IPA passes, you know, I would be very happy to answer. And I'm not sure how much time I have. I think it's still 15 minutes. 12 more minutes. So the other part is I would like to speak about how the inliner got to the shape what it is doing today and why. So it's a little bit of the history lesson. As far as I know, we had a couple of generations of the inliner implementation. So the first inliner is what we had in the time I started to work on GCC. It was the Artio inliner, and it worked like in the bottom-up manner. Basically, we got the function to the RTL form. We did some very minimal optimization, like folding and probably nothing much else. And then we looked on the functions which we previously decided that they are probably good for inlining, and we inline them. And then we saw if the function is good enough for inlining, and if it was good enough for inlining, we saved a copy of this function before we proceed with optimizations. And it was done in the source order, so it means that the users had to explicitly put the inline function before its uses. And it has some kind of true thresholds. One was for inlined the declared functions, the other threshold was for auto-inlining. So if the function was smaller than 10 statements or 10 instructions, it was inline, something like that. This inliner was rewritten by Kotsosari in 1999, and it changed the representation, so it was working on trees, and it was also changed in the way it works. It became the top-down inliner. So we were saving the body before inlining, so in the original shape. Then we was inlining recursively. So after inlining a function, we look if we can inline more. And then we did all the optimizations, because at that time we had nothing to do on the trees. We was not really able to optimize them, which they got changed. I was looking about why the order was changed. And this is the explanation from Mark Michel about a year later. So he was basically explaining that it was the memory optimization, because when you have the function which is not going to the final program, the top-down inliner still does, the bottom-up inliner still does inlining into it. Here you are really inlining only to the functions which you are really going to generate. So the idea was to make the compiler faster and use less memory. It didn't really happen. There was quite large regressions. You know, one of the first was noticed by Gerald Pfeiffer. That was the famous bug report, which I got the t-shirt for. And that was something like 40% regression. But then Richard Gintner got to be interested in GCC because he had much bigger regression. It was something like 70 times regression on his strange Puma-based solver. So what happened here is that, you know, if you do the top-down inlining, first you completely ignore the fact that the optimizers can optimize away some of the code. And the second is that the inliner doesn't really cluster the program very well. So I have kind of if you have the original algorithm that was inlining every function smaller than 5 statements, then if you have a long inlining chain, you are basically ignoring these functions because they're inline and you start with this function. And what happens is that you inline everything into this function because all of them are small. And you output it into the assembler. And then you look on the other function and inline everything again because all of them are small. And you get it into the assembler. And then you look on the last function and you do it too. So basically you get uncontrolled growth on the functions if you have deep enough call stacks. And that's what C++ does these days. You have something like 40 wrapper calls before you do something useful. So it became extremely difficult to tune the inliner. And the patch which we eventually ended up was adding kind of slope. So you know, the first inlining was 10 statements, the other inlining was 5 statements, the next inlining was 2 statements, it was decreasing. So the slope basically limits you to inline some limited amount of functions. And then you see that the static 6 has to be generated too. So you inline into it and you proceed with the F2. And you inline the 3 functions again and you see that a static F5 has to be generated. So you inline into it and then you do F1 and then you see that the static F4 has to be generated. So you inline into it and then you output static F7. Which means that you get pretty big program because every function in your program is growing 3 times. And then if you look what the bottom-up inliner does, it starts from the end and it does nothing on F7. It inlines F7 to F6. It inlines F6 into F5, which already contains F7. And then it cannot inline into F4 because F5 is already too big. So it inlines F4 into F3, and it inlines F3 into F2, and then it inlines this way. And what you get is one big static function and moderately sized address. So it's much more code than the previous version, and it. It's actually pretty much same performance because if you look at the F1, it has one call and the other call, and if you look at the F1 here, it has one call, then it has other call here. So that's why you know the bottom-up inliner is actually pretty simple to tune because it somehow naturally clusters your program into the small enough functions and generates reasonable code. So that's where I got interested in the inliner because we were somehow unable to tune the top-down inliner to do something useful. And in 2003, I got the idea that in the free time, I will implement the call graph and I will try to do inlining on the call graph, which has turned into something like 3 years of effort. And basically, the difficult part was turning GCC to work at the unit at the time. The easy part was to implement some working inliner. I didn't think too much about it, so I did very simple analysis. I improved the original code by kind of accounting that no op conversions of nothing. I implemented some kind of very simple rules, which are limiting the number of instructions you can inline. They was limiting the growth of the function, and they was limiting the growth of the units. So I was sure that the inliner will not explode. And I made a very simple heuristics, which was driven by the greedy algorithm, and the greedy algorithm was basically driven by the overall growth for inlining the given function into all of its uses. So basically I was optimizing for the static number of inline functions, different types of inline functions, not for the static number of inline calls. And I added the inliner, which is inlining every function called once, which was static. So this solved the problem with the compile time and size. And it became easier to tune, but it needed this unit at the time, which took another 2 years to be converted into C++. And it didn't really solve all the problems. Like if you take the function, you inline it into the other function, you can optimize the code away. But if you inline the other function million times, then you have to optimize the code million times. So this is actually few texts I thought about how the inliner should be organized. This is Chris Lattner basically explaining that all the inlining you want to do should be bottom-up inlining. He's describing that you don't duplicate the work if you do bottom-up inlining, and that's how it works in the LLVM. And this is the Richard Günther explaining that all the inlining you should do should be global inlining, and there should be only global limits, no local limits, because it's much easier to tune. So basically, every compiler developer gets different different opinion on the inliner. So to make everyone happy, I actually implemented both. And that is a reason why you want to use the greedy algorithm. You know, if you do the bottom-up inlining, then it works from top to down in my picture. And I have, you know, relatively big function, which is called by relatively small function. And this call, you know, and the bottom inliner starts here, it does nothing. It looks here and it sees there is this call. The call is not so cool to inline, but it has a limit to be inlined. So it makes a single inline. And then it gets into these calls. And these calls might be very hot. Like, you know, you have very hot calls. And now the bottom-up inliner is lost, because either it has to duplicate the relatively big function very many times, or it has to not inline the hot calls, because we already glued these two functions together and forgot the unglued version of it. So if you implement the greedy algorithm will first look on the hot calls, it will inline the small function, and it will keep the called function offline. Or maybe it will consider it inline sometimes and not always. So that's the main benefit of the global algorithm. And what's the problem of this global algorithm was quite seen on the Trump 3D benchmark, which was
5 minutes.
Okay, I will try to be fast, which was extremely useful at that time. The Trump 3D was one of the first codes I have seen in my life, which is something like 20 nested calls for every single useful instruction which is output in the final assembly. And I'm not counting the other code around, you know, the abstraction penalty is extreme. And then, you know, the inliner, which doesn't know that the code will be optimized away, it's accounting for this abstraction penalty in the cost matrix. And it's pushing you up with the limits how the unit grows. So it's very difficult to tune it with the greedy inliner. So you have to make very insane large growth limits to get something sane. And yeah, I wanted to explain this, I will skip it. And so one thing I did is that I added some optimistic assumptions. I simply optimistically assuming that some of the code will be optimized away, even though it's not necessarily optimized away in the practice. So I'm anticipating that all the scalar replacement will happen, that all the moves which are implied by calling conventions will go away, and so on. And the other part is that I implement the early inliner, which is organized in the way that it works in the reverse post order, so basically in the topological order. And it always implements the simple bottom-up inlining based on the simple code size limits. Then it performs the optimizations, which removes the garbage which appeared by inlining. And then I keep the function body. So that's basically how the LLVM inliner works. So this type of inliner is extremely effective on this type of code, you know, when you have a lot of little wrappers and a large abstraction penalty. It's not so good on these global decisions, which I will get to later if I have another 3 minutes. So the next thing which I ran into was the stack frame size. Like, I killed completely glibc, because glibc has printf. The printf has having huge formatting function with a huge stack, and I always inline it, and the glibc exploded. So we added the edit bounds for the stack growth. And the next work was basically accounting profile, because like in this code, it's probably not important to inline this function because it's going to be executed once. So we have the profile, we can say what is hot, what is cold, we can drive the priorities based on this. And I also made the inline analysis to predict the time of the function, and I can then make the speed up over the cost size ratio as the basic way how to drive the optimizer. We also implemented the indirect inlining, which is Martin's work, which is important for some of the test cases. we implemented the partial inlining, which is basically the separate splitting part. So here, you know, this part of the function is small and fast, and usually you don't get here. So it's good to split the function here and inline only the header of it, which we do kind of proactively. We simply split every function which seems to be splittable, and then we see what inliner does about it. And next thing I ran into is in 4.5 we got kind of fiasco by big slowdowns on Firefox, which is the reason I'm playing with Firefox till today. And the problem back then was that the OS inliner was actually tuned to inline only when it really knows that the code will shrink. And it's in C++, you have to gamble. You have to predict that the code will shrink because it's abstraction penalty around. So we had to retune OS quite a lot. And we also ran into the interesting case that the comdat functions are made to be shared between units, but in 90% they are not. They are unique for every individual compilation unit. So it's good to add it into the cost model. Simply expect that the comdat will likely will be like static function. The next thing is that we started accounting the function context. So I implemented a kind of predicate engine, which is saying that in this function, something depends on the parameter. So if the operation parameter zero is not zero, then this is the large part. And something depends needs to be recomputed only when the parameter change. So that's this change predicate, and something will be optimized away when you inline the function. So this is kind of very simple and quite fast predicate engine, which lets you to predict how the function will behave when you inline. And I'm slowly getting to 2013, you see. And there are still some cases which I need to optimize better, but it was also necessary for IPACP. Until then, we didn't have any idea how the propagation can improve your code. So in 2012, I got bored and I was starting to look on the benchmark, which are kind of ugly and stupid. One of the very good examples is a C-ray, which has this type of internal loop. That is, for every pixel, it makes a single array, and it is trying to bounce it on every sphere in the list. And the point of this example is that if you inline the array sphere, then the benchmark gets something like 40% faster. And the reason is that the array is a loop invariant, and good part of the array sphere is actually depends only on the array. It doesn't depend on the sphere. So the inlining enables the invariant motion. And that was the reason, okay, I'm quick. That was the reason why I actually added this changes predicated. So I'm able to handle this. And yeah, what I'm fighting with now is how to handle this with the whole program, because the bigger your program gets, the more calls you can inline. And the stupid inliner is getting more and more happy. It makes your code much, much bigger than before. So we need to somehow cut the inliner for the big programs. So we really need to identify the cases where the inlining doesn't make sense. It's like, you know, with the Firefox, if you limit the unit growth to 5%, you still get all the performance benefits, but your binary is much, much smaller than by default. So you can get pretty much OS size binary with the O3 performance with LTO, which is a nice story. And yeah. So we need to somehow model the negative effects of inlining. This is another quote from Linus declaring me stupid. But at the moment, GCC has basically no idea what harmful effects inlining might have, except for the code size, which is not always the good plans. Yeah, this is some of the plans for the IPA optimization. Okay.
Thank you very much. I would suggest taking the questions offline as lunch is being served now. Mm-hmm.